back to all these problems with racism that we have today and so on. You know that we have today, and this brought me into a lot of trouble. When I check the internet, I don't do it regularly, but from time to time my friends draw my attention to the fact how, ooh, you are again attacked, as now in late time. Once I was attacked at anti-Semite, then I was attacked at justifying Arab terrorism, then I was attacked, I love this, for the same book, of the most perfidious Zionist propaganda. Now the last attacks are that I am a fascist European nationalist, anti-immigrant, and so on and so on. Maybe it's true, but I'm tempted to defend myself here as a Hegelian. Why? Let me go into it. You know, it's in Europe now we have, and I developed this in that article in these times, we have this, on the one hand, of course, anti-immigrants who claim all these immigrants are a threat to European Christian identity, blah, blah, and all those paranoiac theories. It's not a spontaneous event. It's all planned by enemies of Europe and so on and so on. Well, frankly, even in this, there is a moment of truth, I claim. Don't kill me. I'm not now a European. You know, in what sense? Isn't there something strange happening with these refugees? Look, we have poor Middle East countries, relatively poor. Egypt, Turkey, Iran. Each of them received 1 to 2 million immigrants. We have Europe, which is definitely more wealthy, and it's so-so, relatively open. Then we have the really rich countries, Saudi Arabia, Qatar, Kuwait, Emirates. You know how many refugees they received? Zero. Zero. And it's absolutely disgusting, I claim, because first, they are culturally much closer. You know, like Saudi Arabia even cannot claim, oh, it's a civil war there, we want to remain a conservative country or whatever. First, Saudi Arabia is not a conservative country. Maybe they play this game theologically, but socially, it's a kind of a big capital mafia, gangster family. It's all about American money, oil, reinvesting it. It's the most speculative capital modern country in this sense. So they, or all those rich countries, their official politics is not even one, although not only most of the refugees are Sunnis, more than Shias, so religiously they are the same. Even worse, at least in Syria, it's clear that, it's not even a secret, that Saudi Arabia together with Turkey is supporting the rebels and so on. So you cannot say, sorry, this wasn't our problem, why should we take the refugees? No, they play a key role in creating the crisis in Syria. So, but my point is not so much this, my point is, and this brought me all the trouble. Opposed to those whom, of course, I oppose, those European cultural jerks, you know, like who threat to Christian identity and so on and so on. The formula to which I stick all the time here for decades is, of course, I am for European values, but they are really threatened by those anti-immigrant. Like, imagine Europe where Marine Le Pen is in power in England, where I don't know who, UKIP France, UKIP in England, and so on. That would have been really the end of Europe, I think, no? But there is another point here. Then we get these left liberals, and those I oppose, because I think it's a politically false, hypocritical position. Their attitude is, first, they accept this infinite self-flagellation, how do you call it, European masochist criticism. We are guilty, totally. So we should totally open our borders and so on and so on. I claim that, yes, I developed this in a very traditional Marxist way. Not Europe, but let's say today's economic, mostly economic neocolonialism is clearly the main cause of this great flow of refugees, because again, without American intervention in Iraq, no ISIS, because ISIS is a reaction to, you know, one of the beautiful things that United States did in Iraq is the result of their intervention was that the pro-Iranian Shias are now the predominating force. So another big success of American politics. Why don't we give as a present to our Iranian friends, Iraq, another country, no? But, and incidentally, I don't have time to go into it, but I'm so unsure what is this ISIS. I don't want to be, usually I try to avoid this stupid paranoia, you know, like September 11th was really an, you know, this total racism, anti-Semitism, in the sense of, you know, this stupid, like, all the Jews got a message 2 days before, don't go on 11th of September to Twin Towers and so on, all that bullshit. But with ISIS, things are the least one can say extremely obscure. I'm not sure who, what is behind it, but what I want to say is this. Yes, I totally accept this argumentation. Either it's this warfare interventions there in Libya, or it's simply economic neocolonialism. Like what's going on, for example, in Central African Republic. Alain Badiou drew my attention to it. The official story is this one, another ethnic warfare between the Christian majority and on northeast of the country, Muslim minority. And again, wild locals, we Europeans, should we intervene or not? Ha ha ha. We know the story now, but it's totally ignored in our media. But I believe the story for the simple reason Alain Badiou told me this and showed me the clips. You know, he learned the story from Le Figaro, which is the right-wing daily, but just they report a small item. Unfortunately, they discovered oil in the Muslim northeast of the country. The whole of country was being gradually colonized by the Chinese. So this explosion of old ethnic passions, fuck you, it was simply, it was strictly triggered by the conflict of economic neocolonial interest between China and France. Even you, United States, I don't always blame you. You know, we really live in multicentric world today, which is, as much as this is difficult to accept for some leftists, but when there is some horrible thing going on in the world, you are not automatically the guilty part. You know what, like, I wish all the best to the Chinese, but unfortunately, I must tell you, what Chinese are doing in many African countries or in Myanmar, ex-Burma, and so on. Well, if the term economic colonialism has any meaning, this is what they are doing there. Even I remember, I don't know, sorry if I repeat myself, I was at some subversive festival in Zagreb, capital of Croatia, a couple of years ago, 2 years ago, just before Varoufakis wasn't yet a minister, and there was some crazy guy, leftist sociologist, who claimed that European poor countries who are now screwed by Germany, they should delink from Europe and open up to, like he advised this to Greeks, no, if Syriza win, step out of European Union, open up yourself to Russia and China. Yeah, good luck, because they said, he said, okay, they are not maybe democratic, but at least they will not force upon you your ideology, which means basically they like local dictators with whom it is. But then there were some 50, 100 Greeks in the hall who just started to laugh like crazy. And then why? Because then they told me, you know that Chinese tried to buy the port of Piraeus, and they did something there that no Western colonialist, imperialist dares to do it today. They did it so brutally. They fired half of the people. They found some legal loophole to prevent any trade union. So just don't mention to Syriza progressive Chinese. As to the Russians, yes, Tsipras did play this game a little bit. But again, privately, when I met him in Zagreb, he told me, no illusions about Putin, he told me, Russians did send a delegation, no? And they told him, okay, if you do Grexit, we can give you tens of billions to survive, but, and but was a pretty brutal but. First, you should allow us to buy all those remaining state companies like Telecom, which still somehow work, and B, a big, nice, juicy Greek island for 100 years as our military base and so on. You know, so no illusions here. So again, let's make this first point clear. I'm not claiming we Europeans are clean here. We are absolutely, but not only us, we Chinese, United States are absolutely responsible for this vague of refugees. The problem is, no, there is no problem. This simply is a fact. The problem is this one, how to react to it. I was so attacked as a racist when I noticed that, and in Slovenia I met them, the refugees, and I respect this, I don't blame them for this, but it's almost tragic how they are possessed with a certain vision, how should I put it. For example, we Slovenes are not a rich country, but also not terribly poor, like our per capita is now around 30,000, well, this is not ultra poverty, no? And, you know, dozens of refugees interviewed by our TV cameras said, we don't like this country, it's too poor. Norway, we want Norway. And at the same time, all of them repeated the same formula, like, I know what I want. Norway government will give me a big apartment, they will provide university education for my children, I know one of my sons should become a surgeon, the other one should become whatever, and so on and so on. Well, my silicon answer was 3/4 of Slovenes would like the same, no. But I don't blame them for that. But the tragedy is that they don't get it that their dream is, for strictly formal reasons, impossible. Impossible in this sense. At the same time, that's the irony. Whenever authorities in Slovenia, Croatia, whenever try to, often they do it in a brutal way, and I protested against it. But often they just said, okay, we allow you to enter, just please to organize provisions, food, medical help. My God, we have to register you, no? And then they shout usually, no, we are not cattle, we are humans, we want freedom. But fuck you, you want this freedom and then you want to go to Norway. I don't think there is a country in the world, because I'm sorry to tell you, but that's how modern, if it still works, welfare state functions. Everyone is totally registered with all your problems and so on, because that's how the state takes care of you. So to go back to this, what am I saying? Should we not allow them to enter? No, my problem is, my solution is, along the lines of Fred Jameson's wonderful text, this mad text, now it's already being in the process, it will appear soon by Warsaw, a volume of Fred Jameson replies to him, and then his short reply, An American Utopia, where he claims that the only American chance of its madness, of radical change, communism, is militarization. And I claim maybe this would be a to the shock of my leftist friends, I claim a military solution would have worked. Not in this bad sense, you know. But the only way to resolve the crisis is to establish some refugee, how would we call them, reception camps in the places where you still can do it, on the coast of Syria, Lebanon, Turkey, and so on, and then to somehow organize the movement. No? I mean, I don't see any, first, I don't see, Europe should fully admit its duty, I pose no doubt here. I just emphasize, and here I agree with Habermas, who said that he's sick and tired with this false, how should I call it, sentimentalization. Where is our humanity? Where is our empathy? No, to provoke things, one TV station, they stopped me on the street, I heard that boycott them in Slovenia, they asked me, would you accept a refugee family into your apartment? I told them, no, I hate people other in my apartment. I even don't like to have my own family in my apartment. But I said, I know we are, the problem is not to love them. The problem is simple, full ethical responsibility. If you take half of my money that I earn, and I don't earn as much as maybe it appears, and I immediately accept that. Don't sentimentalize it. Habermas was right, where he says, this Europe is deeply responsible for this. This is why it's Europe's duty but to do it. But I think without this bullshit, you know, open the borders and so on. Yes, open the borders, but in an organized way. Now comes the really evil part. The problem is this one, which they embody it, the refugees. Again, they want Europe, and it's a legitimate dream, but that's the problem. All dreams of emancipation are inconsistent, and you have to move further. First step, they want to maintain their cultural identity and fully participate in a European welfare state. I claim for theoretical reasons, this doesn't work. That's where I don't believe in multiculturalism. Not in the sense because our culture is higher and so on. My problem is this one, and for this I'm now proclaimed, I don't know, secret fascist right-winger. You know, the problem with multiculturalism is that it relies on a certain liberal legalistic dream which simply doesn't work. The idea is each community can maintain, if it wants, of course, it can also mix with others, its own way of life. The state just has to guarantee the, how should I call it, peaceful coexistence without violence and so on. I claim this absolutely doesn't and cannot work for the simple reason that every cultural identity is never just about yourself, of ourselves. It involves the notion of how you relate to others, plus there is another mega problem. Every culture has its own inherent antagonisms, conflicts, and so on. For example, my good friend Udi Aloni, who is sometimes even more crazy than you or me, which is quite an achievement then, he told me a wonderful story. There is a Palestinian rapper, I forgot his name, I'm sorry, who recently visited United States, and about a year ago, I think, he gave a concert at UCLA. And you know what happened there? And one of his songs was against honor killings. He also protests, of course, Zionist oppression, blah, blah. But he was immediately attacked there by some fanatical anti-Zionists, but wrong ones, I think, that why do you mention this? Don't you know that this serves the purposes of Zionism and so on? Basically, they accused him of being a Zionist spy, slave, or whatever. And he gave a wonderful, dignified answer to this, of course, wealthy student. He said that the difference between you and me is that you study in one of the richest universities in the world, and you talk in this way to guarantee your career, to become popular with your wealthy, wealthy pseudo-radical professors in English, while I, in my country, sing in Hebrew and Arab to help women who really suffer there. And so you see this hypocrisy. Instead of being glad, we don't have to patronize the Palestinians. We just have to join their own struggle. And they are not so marginal. It's a whole still minority, but a very strong movement on the West Bank, which says, okay, anti-Zionist struggle, but at the same time, my God, we have many problems of our own, like honor killings and so on. And to give you an example, they even have wonderful sense of humor. They absolutely don't fit this ridiculous idea of, you know, fanatical Palestinians. Like, I'm sorry if you know this story, it's not a dirty one. It's a wonderful one. It's based on that mistranslation. Every good, so I was told, scientist, who a historian of Quran, knows that, you know, that stupid idea. If you are a martyr and go to heaven, you get 70 virgins and so on. Everybody knows that this is a translation mistake. The term used in Quran designates the top quality white grape raisins. And the expression, you will get 70, it's not virgins. This was at that time, 6th, 7th century, the standard phrase for hospitality. It means, I give you a whole fist of raisins, it means you are a welcome guest. And Palestinians told me this wonderful joke. There is an ugly Palestinian guy who wants to screw girls, he's ugly, no girl wants him. So he says, my God, I will become a martyr, I kill myself, I go up and I will get it there. Okay, he does it. He awakens in paradise and gets the raisins. And then he says, sorry, mistake, can I go back, please? It was all a linguistic misunderstanding. So, you know what I'm saying here? This is the, I hate all those liberal centrist atheists, which are now fashionable in the United States. Let's name them. Sam Harris, Richard Dawkins, and so on. You know why? First, they are not really neutral. I strategically agree with them when they criticize some type of radical left for you are allowed to mock everyone except Islam. Like, we should be tender there. You are immediately accused of Islamophobia. I agree with this. I absolutely think we should be ruthless also towards Islam. But the problem I have is that then let's be ruthless towards everyone. You know my problem with, you remember that Charlie Hebdo murders, you know. I always explode when I hear the story, oh my God, how open we are in Europe. You see, it's our spirit that you can make fun of everything. Those stupid Arabs think some topics, Muslims are out, unmentionable. But it's not like this. And I think it's even good that it's not like this. Every culture has its, how should I call it, unmentionable points. Like, okay, in Europe you can make fun of Mohammed, but can you make fun of Holocaust? Try to do this and you will see how you will also be immediately excommunicated. Now, wait a minute. My point is not, so let's allow this also. My point is simply that to prohibit some things ethically is not in itself a bad thing. Now, to provoke you, I will say it's even a sign of progress. I'm from progressive dogmaticism. Maybe you know the story, I will repeat it. Would you really like to live in a society where you would have to argue like Habermasians, rational argumentation, why women should not be raped, you know? No, I would like to live in a society where this is, in a good sense, simply accepted as a self-evidence. So when some guy starts to deploy this tasteless line, you know, ooh, but don't you see she secretly enjoyed it and so on, you don't have to argue. The guy simply immediately appears as an idiot. You know, in this sense, I claim the first thing to accept is that, of course, it's not the same. I'm not saying our taboos are the same as their taboos. I'm just saying the first clear point. Every culture has its taboos. Don't have any illusions here. At certain level, we are more tolerant, but things are much more ambiguous. Let me tell you a story. This time, I think I don't repeat myself, at least not here. I used this yesterday in Brown Providence, but not here. You remember when some 3-4 years ago, when he was still president, Ahmadinejad, while he was at UN, visited Colombia, and there was a big public debate there. Now, I don't know if this is true, but I spoke with two Iranian friends of mine who told me something very interesting. What? They were there and they told me, and again, they were not friends, no friends of Ahmadinejad. My God, they were emigrants escaping Islamic Revolution. But they said that the translation was totally misleading. Namely, as you could have expected, some guy provocatively asked Ahmadinejad, how about homosexuals? How do you deal with them in Iran? And Ahmadinejad's reply was translated as, we don't have these problems, there are no homosexuals in Iran. Then, of course, everyone laughed and so on. But my friend told me, no, he gave effectively a much more refined answer. Something like, we deal with this in a totally different way than you. We don't talk about it and allow you to do it discreetly. And my friend told me that basically the implicit reference, because Ahmadinejad was an idiot, but he knew, you know, for them it's also the sacred book, the Old Testament. You know, is it, sorry, now comes my barbarism, is it the first or the second? Christ. No, fuck off Christ. It's the first of the, or the second commandment, you should celebrate no other gods. But you know that. Second. But you know how it says completely. In front of me. You shouldn't do it in front of me. It doesn't mean in front of me, of course, God is boss. So the idea is do it discreetly but out of my sight. You have it even there. And you see, here we encounter all this ambiguities of the notion of neighbor, how to regulate it, and so on. This is why, but I already talked about this in my classes, I don't to take, no, you know what, I've spoken already way too long, so let me nonetheless conclude. So my idea is this one, and whenever I hear this people who claim, oh, Islamophobia, you shouldn't criticize the refugees, I say, tell them, first, I absolutely admit European responsibility. We should even give, I don't know, like 30-40% of our budget, my God, fully open. But there is a but. My but is this one. For example, I recently saw, you can copy it on, I mean, look it on YouTube, the ZDF, and ZDF, Zweites Deutsches Rundfunk, remember, is the relatively social democratic leftist one, a report on honor killings and this in Muslim community in West Germany. And it's terrifying what you learn there. It's not a marginal phenomenon, you know, because people usually always name this example. It's easy to agree with them. Isn't it horrible that in France the state prohibited wearing the burqa, how do you call it here, the veil, whatever. I agree with it. But the problem is not this one. The problem is not the girl wants to wear it, the state prohibits it. Here I agree. But what if the girl doesn't want to wear it and her family threatens her? Now, my friend anti Islamophobic tell me, oh, you are a victim of Zionist Western propaganda, these are just marginal cases. No, 2,000 to 3,000 per year in Germany. Such strong cases that the girls have to escape, and then they have already 25 around, how do you call it, exile, asylum home, where these girls are treated like, how do you call them, protected victims, you know, given anonymity, new identity, and so on and so on. And then Islam community says, and in a way they are right, but you are here privileging your ethics, which your ethical substance, which gives greater accent to individual freedom, to our, where community, collaboration, mutual help has greater predominance. So here I'm brutal. I wonder, I'm trying really to provoke you now, although hopefully you will say, and then I will love you again, Avital, that there is no time for debate or whatever.
That's
no,
exactly.
Yeah, no, sorry, but seriously, now I always ask my friends who accuse me of Eurocentrism and so on. Okay, what about the thing that happened 2 years ago in Slovenia? A gypsy Roma girl escaped from her family, seek refuge in Police because her father, when she was 11, already married her, arranged marriage to her brother, and she didn't want to. And then, of course, all the feminists supported her. But the irony was that the same feminists who supported her were at the same time officially the greatest protectors of multiculturalism. You know, like, blah, blah, blah. And then one of the leaders of Roma community appeared on Slovene TV and said something which was obviously true. He says, are you aware that arranged marriages are one of the absolutely crucial mechanisms of the reproduction of our society? You take this from us and then we will survive, but a kind of a tourist spectacle people, you know. You come to listen to our songs, our food, but effectively as a society we will disappear. So what's my lesson here? It's not that I'm offering any easy solution, but the first thing is to establish that you have to make a choice here. You cannot say, no, even with Alain Badiou, I had a small conflict here because he said, no, state should be should remain above all this. Okay, but I told him, let's say a girl comes to the police, or a more extreme example, then they are more rare. Here there is definitely a lot of Western propaganda, but nonetheless, a girl comes and says, okay, I want to avoid clitorodectomy. So what will you say? No, is there a cultural problem? Let's not do it, and so on, and so on. I mean, I'm claiming that, you know, this is why, just to shock and provoke my friends, I tried to rehabilitate the notion of light culture, leading culture, not in the sense of our Christianity, but what I think we should not be ashamed to impose is certain rules which regulate how different cultures relate to each other. For example, this is not a marginal problem. My friends told me from Malmo, Berlin, and Amsterdam that gay communities were first well disposed towards Muslims. But then Muslims start to attack gays publicly. Okay, Judith Butler, I admire her for this, did the heroic thing. Because as a reaction to this, gay community made some Islamophobic, not homophobic, that would be too much, statements. She refused to accept a big prize offered by her there. But nonetheless, you see what I mean. There is no easy way out. At a certain level, you have to impose some rules. You cannot escape it. And this is, for me, light culture. And I'm here moderately Eurocentric, and I will tell you why. Because it's so suspicious for me today, why is it all of a sudden so acceptable to be anti-Eurocentric? I think this is not a good sign of victory of anti-colonial struggle. On the contrary, it's one of the signs of the dark times we are approaching when, as I always emphasize, capitalism no longer needs democracy